Charger Victor 1, Romeo Kilowatt 59.
K1N looking for Noah's Ark.
K1N, Kilo 1, Navassa.
It seems as though getting a DXpedition to Navassa Island would be pretty easy, at least compared to some of the other places in the world we've been. It's nestled in there between Jamaica, Cuba, and Haiti, a chip shot from the United States, and a boat landing on one of those big beaches should be a piece of cake. Except, they're not beaches. They're 40 to 60 foot sheer cliffs. You used to be able to get there by boat. There had been a ladder in tiny Lulu Bay. That's it in this movie shot by Steve Smith, WA4VWV, for the KC-4DX operation in 1972. And that's what most of the previous DXpeditions to the island used. Steve's now a silent key. And that's our K1N webmaster, Chaz Cohn, W4GKF, still very much alive, after taking his life in his hands on that ladder back in 1972. Here's another look at that ladder from the 1978 N0TG operation. Yeah, so Navassa used to have DXpeditions every few years, and some years it was every few months. Most of them counted for DXCC. A few didn't. But the last one was way back in 1993. The coastline remained forbidding, and the ladder was removed, and the U.S. government took a much more active interest in managing the island through the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. For decades, hams weren't allowed to operate there. So slowly, Navassa climbed the most wanted lists until it reached number one or number two, depending on which list you were looking at. We have a bonus feature on this DVD, the K1N presentation that was part of the DX Forum at the 2015 Dayton Hamvention, produced by the Ham Radio Now podcast. And in it, co-leader Bob Allphin, K4UEE, explains the process we went through to get permission for the K1N operation.
Does anybody have any idea how long the KP-15 project took to get to Navassa? 13 years. The conclusion is, it's easier to go to the moon than to Navassa.
It might have been easier to land on the moon, too. Because that ladder was gone, we couldn't rely on a boat trip, all because of that last few feet.
The only variable is being able to get on and off the island. That's the thing.
And because this was going to be a big, long operation, we decided to go by helicopter. And if that seems like the luxury way out, well, you'll see. But we still needed a boat. Our agreement with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service specified that we needed a boat on standby for an emergency evacuation. So we contracted for the Electra, based in Miami, which just happened to be owned by George, AA7JV, who was one of our team members. Tommy, KT4TTT, George, Mike, N6MZ, and this lobster would travel on the Electra, while the rest of us would fly.
Pop out into the ocean down here.
But where would we fly from? We couldn't fly from Haiti, even though the tip of that island is closer, the nearest airport is too far for our heavy load. We couldn't fly from Cuba, not back then anyway, and we couldn't get permission to fly from Gitmo. So that left Jamaica.
Where exactly are we?
Jamaica, come on.
Absolutely.
96 degrees in the shade.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
96
degrees in the shade.
Why do you live here, Mon?
Mon, it's home.
Murphy visited already. We hoped it was for the last time.
Got gas?
We're at the True Value store in Ocho Rios, and we just picked up 30 5-gallon gas cans, and they're going to be transported to our hotel in our tour bus. This young lady who's checking this out, I think, is the store manager, and Glenn Johnson has been in touch with her for several months, and she has helped us source an awful lot of stuff that we didn't have to buy in the States and ship down here. And I think maybe we should leave some things behind because our bill is $167,783.81. I think you overcharged me for that candy bar. What you looking for, Ralph?
Let's see if they have any Kahlua out here. Yes. I'm not seeing it. They got the Sky Vodka, which is a good start.
We're not real doctors. I'm just a mechanic.
Everything went well. We received the cargo, the boxes, and we stored them in the escort.
That looks familiar. This is good. This is very good.
This is the entourage who's greeting us here. Here are the customs people, the K9 people. And then there's about half of us, and there's a guy that runs the airport. There's Jerry, looking just exactly like Jerry.
From 70 between. There you go. There we go.
My name is Bob Allphin. I live in Atlanta, Georgia, and I am the president of the KP15 project. And what we do is support and participate in expedition, amateur radio or ham radio expeditions to hard to find, hard to reach, usually uninhabited places around the world.
It's about 12:20 on the 29th. We've been staging all morning, and I just love it when the plan comes together. Here he comes. Did you fly over Navassa?
Yes, sir.
We did.
It's good.
I have a couple of pictures of Navassa.
I see a wait a minute.
Good area for
wait
landing.
A minute. Okay. That's not Navassa. This is Lulu Bay.
Yeah, this is Lulu Bay.
Is there a landing spot?
Yep, here.
Big very enough. Close,
yeah.
How far away?
From
100 yards, 100 meters?
100 yards.
We did put some equipment and supplies on the Electra and hoped we could unload them.
Do we need an Allen wrench for this?
George explained what he expected.
Some days, weather will be nice and calm, but probably rolly. And other times, we will have some very strong winds from the north.
Camper survey.
Thank you. Those days will be difficult for the boat to stay around, and obviously, those days will be unsuitable for loading equipment.
And where will you go?
Into the lee of Haiti, or on the very extreme conditions, the boat will run to Jamaica.
But because we couldn't be 100% sure of being able to unload the Electra, we planned a minimum viable configuration of equipment and supplies, and people, to all go by helicopter.
So who's the guy in a brown shirt?
This was our biggest challenge by far. It would take 7 or 8 round trips over a couple of days, so we staged all the supplies for each trip before loading them on the copter.
This is water and fuel. This is a load and a half right here.
That night, we hosted a party with hams from the Jamaica Amateur Radio Association. They were a great help with local logistics. And then we got ready to go.
When we planned this, we estimated that we're going to go to the island, shut down, and maybe we gave you an hour. Loading, unloading, so that we know how many trips we can. If things take a long time, that's why we said an hour. We know how many trips we can leave.
Camp will be where the shadow is here.
Okay, where the shadow is, but we cannot. If you set up the camp here, we cannot use it. This as a landing site because of the downwash of the helicopter is a pretty big downwash, and it's going to blow up your camp.
It's a procedure called ditching, and what usually happens is you can. Depends if there's power or no power, but if there's any power, the pilot
hovers,
everybody exits, then the pilot moves away and then tips the helicopter over to stop the rotor.
Where does the U.S. phone band stop on 15?
200.
Down?
It starts at 200.
Starts at 200, goes all the way up to 450.
Yeah. And where does the European...
general is above 275.
And where does the European phone end?
Starts at 100.
Yep. So you can listen down there too, the same philosophy,
so
like 7, 21, 205, and down.
And what's the top of the band on 12?
990.
990.
That's the side part of the top.
So let's transmit on 970.
24970. That sounds good. So you go up and down, no matter what. Ooh.
Okay. So this graph here is QSOs by date, and it's kind of random because Craig wasn't on every day. But what this will give us is how many Qs we're making in each 24-hour period. So we're trending upwards towards a goal. We are trending down. We need to pick up our game.
So remember that luxury helicopter flight? Well, we loaded this baby up full with barely enough room for the passengers. I wonder who's going to get that ladder in his lap.
Saturday morning, 8:07. We're ready to go in the first flight, and it's going to be Glenn, Jerry, and George Nicholson. All we're doing now is waiting to hear from the law enforcement officer that should be landing on Navassa about now, and he's going to, if all is well and clear, as he puts it, he'll call us on the satellite phone and we will take off. Quickly, we're ready to go.
And once you're out of the aircraft, in case of ditching, you just have to pull out on this real hard and it will deploy the life raft, okay?
Bob, we're on our way, finally, after 15 years maybe?
Yeah, 15.
And it's just about 2 o'clock on January 31st. We're on our way.
We're on our way.
Oh, I forgot to mention the other part of our deal with Fish and Wildlife. They were going to fly a bunch of officers to Navassa, at our expense, to protect us from the occasional Haitian fishermen who wandered by the island, and to protect the island from us. They got to fly from Gitmo, but a congressional junket closed the airport there all morning, so they got a late start, and so we got a late start. All while you were wondering why we weren't on the air yet. But as you'll see in a few minutes, they pitched in and more than carried their own weight. We were glad to have them with us. Turns out several of them were with us on Desecheo, so it was a great reunion.
Here we are on the first helicopter flight in.
Congratulations, Glenn.
Jerry, good to be with you.
Good to be with you.
All right, these boys are returning from their first round trip from Navassa. We've got three guys on the island now. We've spoken to them. We've changed our next load a little bit to accommodate what they have discovered they need, like ant poison, shovels, that kind of thing.
We got there to Navassa in about 1 hour, 20 minutes. And we had a strong headwind, that's why it took us a little longer. But it's great. People there were great. They liked it a lot. That lighthouse is impressive. And everything seems to be going pretty good. While we were there, another helicopter came in from same people, from Guantanamo, from Gitmo. And we started looking for a suitable landing spot. And we will land where we did today. So, because there's no other way.
Where did you land today?
Right next to the lighthouse.
So, when we put up our shelters and we put up our antennas, will we be clear?
Actually, I told Glenn that I think that you're not going to be able to put the shelter that where you planned originally because of that. See, we said that we will land there, and then we would look for a suitable spot for the remaining days, right? But there are no suitable areas. So Glenn is already searching for another nice place where you can put your camp. Today you had 1,325 pounds cargo. For tomorrow it's going to be 1,225.
Oh, 1,200? Okay, 1,200. We have 1,325.
So 100 pound less than you have for today. Unloading the aircraft was really fast. I would say 10 minutes. So it shouldn't take that long.
And if this weather moves on through and the winds subside, that will change everything? I mean, if the winds go away?
Well, it's hard for the winds to go away on this area. It's okay. Called the windy channel, something like that.
Windward passage.
Windward passage. Okay. There you go. Okay. Thank you, sir.
All right.
We're always going to have a headwind and a tailwind, so
yeah.
It doesn't matter where the wind goes.
It's about 7 o'clock. We're loading the load for the first one out tomorrow morning. We're limited to about 1,200 pounds because of the heavy headwinds going from Jamaica to Navassa. They're burning more fuel than they estimated. In fact, they burned about 900 pounds of fuel going to Navassa, leaving them only about 550 in the regular tank. So they did have to use some of the spare gas that was brought along. So we are weighing everything, and we're getting, now that we have people on the island, we're getting feedback about what should come next and in what order. So that's very helpful as well.
This is fearless leader Bob Alphin's turn on the helicopter. He flew with Jeff in M1Y, and now maybe you can see what we mean about it being a luxury flight. And they're off. There's a little Jamaica, and a little ocean, and a little Jeff, and a little Navassa. George made it with the Electra. It was anchored just off Little Lulu Bay. We couldn't resist circling it once before heading to the lighthouse to unload. And sending the Hilo back to Jamaica for another load and the rest of our team. Then we caught up with the crew from Fish and Wildlife, some of them old friends from our operation on Desecheo. As usual, they were all business. The lighthouse is the focal point of the island, the most prominent feature by far.
There's a lighthouse, all 162 feet of it. It was at this time unmanned, battery operated, serviced by the Coast Guard, and since has been decommissioned altogether. This is the entrance to the lighthouse, chained shut. We didn't go in.
The lighthouse was still in use during the N0TG stroke KP1D expedition in 1978, but they did go in and shot some film from the top. It doesn't look like they hung any antennas from it, though. But we did. The lighthouse was decommissioned in 1996, and it was a mess. We cleaned it up, set up stations in and around the base, and hung our wire antennas from several levels, including the top.
We are at the top of the lighthouse, obviously, about 150 feet up. I think the tippy top, the very top's 161 or something like that. It's a nice touch. The helicopter below is the Fish and Wildlife helicopter. Ours is down below. These are the two element steppers that we're using. We've got four of them. Half of them are pointed stateside, half are pointed towards Europe at the moment. This is how we've managed to set up some shelters. You'll notice on the far side over there, we actually have one of the shelters that we brought with us erected inside the old lighthouse keeper's house.
Oh, I almost forgot. The Electra. It would be nice to have the extra goodies that sailed from Miami. With no ladder, George devised a davit and catenary system. That's a scaffolding and a wire, okay? We used it to haul a lot more water and gas and this spare generator onto shore. Then we used the helicopter to move it all to the lighthouse.
This is the proposed landing spot for our helicopter near Lulu Bay.
No, that is not decadent. First, it was paid for. Second, we still had to haul everything from the edge of the cliff to the landing zone, and that almost killed us.
This is what I call a workout.
And yes, those are the Fish and Wildlife guys pitching in. I told you we were glad to have them.
Well, good morning, DX World, and this is Mike Thomas, NA5U, coming to you from Navassa Island National Wildlife Refuge in the K1N 2015 DXpedition. Just a little bit of history of how we all came to this point. In 2002, the KP15 project was formed to bring together a group of amateurs from several different areas that had been working on gaining access to this and this island, as well as Desashayo. And so here it is, 2015, and we're here. We're excited about it. This island is beautiful. The pictures cannot do it justice. We have the greatest respect for those hams that have been here before. The ruggedness of this island is absolutely beyond description. You see lush grass, but actually underneath it is a very rugged fossilized coral remains, and we're enjoying our operation here. We've made about 80,000 contacts today, and we have a few more days of operation, and we're certainly hoping that our objective of getting all-time new ones in the log for all of those that need this rare island, the number one most needed entity in the world, getting that in your logbook. And good luck in the polyps.
K1N.
Hey, hold on a second, Greg. Everybody, we're going to give you all a pretty generous look at the K1N operators on the air on several modes and bands. Only a few people in the world have experienced this level of operating, and we think it's worth a little extra time for you to see and hear it. So pay attention, and remember what you've been told about working DX pileups. There may be a lesson or two in here for you. Okay, Greg, sorry. Carry on.
Sugar Victor 1, Romeo Kilowatt 59.
Roger, Roger, report 559, thank you very much, 73.
Thank you very much, got K1N. Italy, Zulu 7, Italy, Zulu 7 again. Italy, Kilo 7, Lima, Victor Echo 59. Thank you, Kilo 1, November. Lima, Lima, Juliet again.
Italy, Kilo 6,
Lima, Juliet, Juliet, 59.
Italy, Kilo 6, Lima, Lima, Juliet,
59. Lima, Lima, Juliet, 59, thanks. This is Kilo 1, November. Yankee, please. Please, only the November Yankee. November Yankee again. Hotel Bravo 9, Kilo, November Yankee, you're 59. K1N. Okay, the hotel kilowatt again, please. Oscar Echo 8, Hotel India Kilo, you're 59. K1N.
Here's co-team leader and chief videographer Bob Allphin, K4UEE, batting away some annoying assistants and taking an extended selfie video, all while VE3QAA calls patiently. Bob rewards him with a contact and himself with a Frito. And then, I think we're copying a Kilo Fox 8. Didn't quite get his whole call. Somebody's right on his frequency. I don't think he was expecting to get through. He sounds a little flustered. Keep trying. Come on. There you go. Another Frito fortifies Bob for the coming onslaught. Okay, you CW guys. See if you can pick out who Bob's going to work in the next couple of contacts. And close your eyes. We're going to put up titles for the no-codes. Thank you. You know, I think he could go on like this for hours. In fact, he did. Where'd those Fritos go?
Bob, I was on 40-meter SSB all night.
Okay, Japan Hotel.
Craig and I did a tag team thing. He was on 90 minutes, I was on 90 minutes. He was on 90 minutes, I was on 90 minutes. We did 12 hours of that. I have no idea how many hundreds and hundreds of Europeans, North Americans we put in a log. I think probably in excess of 1,500, maybe even
wow.
Maybe even more. Excellent rates, approaching 200 an hour.
On 40 sidemen.
On 40 sidemen.
The meat grinder.
The meat grinder, the hornet's nest. I finished this morning working probably 70 Japanese way after sunrise. I started working them before sunrise, through sunrise, and after sunrise. It was a lot of fun.
How do you feel?
I feel tired.
No kidding, Jerry. Hey, we don't have video of anybody operating 6 meters, but here's the antenna. We made over 200 contacts on 6. We also put in a big effort on 160. This video is W2GD operating the same station on 12 meters in the daytime. But we wanted to show you all the storage batteries and the 2 amps. And here's what some of you sounded like to us on top band.
This is our North America 160 Qs.
Glenn has a really cool set of images showing where we made 160-meter contacts around the world. They're in his talk at the Dayton Hamvention, and yes, it's included as the bonus on this DVD, so don't miss it. Now, do I hear rain?
It is raining like crazy. The wind must be blowing 35 or 40 knots. The tent's blowing around. The operators can't get back and forth between the stations. Power is miserable. We lost the generator.
This has been a drastic change.
I just hope we don't lose power. K1 light and power, you know, it hasn't been tested in all this environmental stuff.
I think it's being tested tonight, though, right?
Yes, it is.
How about you, Jerry?
This rain sucks, Bob.
Hey, George, what's going on?
I'm covering up the computers. The rainstorm, getting everything wet.
How long has it been going on?
About 10 minutes. I'm going outside to get some wood to build an ark.
Hey, maybe this would be a good time to get a shower.
A bar of soap is all we need right out here.
All right, here you go.
CQ, CQ, CQ. K1N looking for Noah's Ark. Well, that heavy downpour that we just had, after it was over, about 15 minutes later, the generators started cutting out. We lost several generators. We had one backup that we put online, and it's running fine. We're taking and trying to dry out the MegTet generator with the exhaust from this generator. And then we have a fan drying out the electronics on these two.
Welcome to the Red Booby Inn on Navassa Island. This is our Meg tent, our meeting, eating, and greeting tent. Because of our limited amount of weight that we could carry onto the island, it all came by helicopter instead of carrying, like we did on Desecheo 5 years ago, a freezer and a refrigerator and a cook stove and a chef. We were very limited in weight. So we have MREs to eat. That's meals ready to eat. And this is enough food for one person for 1 week, 3 meals a day. There's 21 meals in here. So I'll show you how this works. This is a box of shredded beef, water, and binder. The way you eat these is it's a little tear and you tear it off. This is shredded beef in barbecue sauce. That is really good.
So what goes in must you know.
Well, I think I have maybe the most important job in the camp. Hi, I'm Mike, N6MZ.
Unfortunately, all the jobs were already taken on this little camping trip, so I got the pleasure of taking care of the latrine. Now, some of the guys don't call MREs meals ready to eat. They call them meals refusing to exit. I saved my favorite one. It's called shredded beef, water, and binder product in barbecue sauce. Well, I'm here to tell you there's no exit problem on this little camping trip.
1, 2, 3, 4, 4 seconds. Ouch, that's pretty low. Let's raise our sights with a satellite contact.
Radio Victor Tango.
Kilo Bravo 1, Radio Victor Tango, 5-9.
5-9 Vermont.
Thank you, K1N.
Kilo Bravo 1, Tango.
Okay, the 888 only, please.
Good morning, my name is Brian Marcia. I am the law enforcement supervisor for the Fish and Wildlife Service out of Puerto Rico. We are here on Navassa Island with the DX Expedition, K1N. My main function here is to provide protection and security service for the DXers. We do have some Haitian fishermen who come up to the base camp every now and then. Our job is to keep the ham radio operators safe. When the Haitians do come up to the base camp, we try to interact with them. We try to see what they're about. We're trying to make sure that they come to the base camp, they get the water, and then they go back to fishing. That's all they do on the main island.
10-4, so we're good then. Everything secure?
Before Bob, I gave them one of the water jugs. That way they can, because that's what they were going to do. So now they have no need for a couple days to go up.
10-4, Bob's good with that.
We just want to make sure that the operators continue to operate on a 24-hour basis. They're not interfered. They can make the most amount of contact, which is our main goal.
Yeah, Brian spoke to the Haitians. They're on land right now. So they're going to camp down there. He gave them the spiel that we have gear down there. They're not to touch it. And the 15th, when we depart, when everybody, there's going to be some stuff left here. They can help themselves to it.
I don't speak Haitian Creole, but I was able kind of to mimic through charades kind of the stuff we wanted to tell them, and they kept saying helicopter, helicopter, and I've also told them that we will leave some stuff for them, and they will be very happy when they come back and pick all that stuff up.
And they were. And they didn't need that missing ladder or our catenary and David. They just climbed up and down the cliffs. Our most adventurous team member, George, AA7JV, demonstrated that he could scale the cliffs too. He also went scuba diving to retrieve the anchor that held the davit line in place in Lulu Bay. Meanwhile, Tommy demonstrated the emergency evacuation technique using the sling on the davit. Which was probably almost as terrifying as climbing down the cliff.
Roger, Roger, Julian Alpha to Lima Papa Oscar. Thank you very much. You're 5x9, 5x9, and you were the last station in the K1N November bug. We're going QRT right now. 73, signing out.
Well, you guys really, really brought it to a stirring conclusion, didn't you?
There were pileups on 40 meters. I kept looking at that. It was as if it was the first day. And it made me feel really bad to even leave that pileup.
And I had to shut off a pileup of JAs on 80 meters, 75 meters this morning.
We decided we were going to, once you said we're going to quit at 6. And then we decided 6:30.
And then Billy said, keep going to maybe 6:30. And we did. That was at 6:30 with both of them.
Yeah, and then we started tearing everything down.
And the whole camp is totally clean. There's not one thing left.
The Haitians came.
How many are you talking about?
Four boat crews.
The items that we left for them were tents, fuel, gas, fuel,
water. They had but
tables, chairs.
I got to tell you, the big thing to them was the things that we gave to them personally. Our hats, his coffee cup.
I gave him the shirt off my back.
Yeah, literally he gave the shirt off his back.
And the sandals too.
Yeah, but they took the table and put it on their head. They put a step ladder on top of the table.
And
they had chairs
on
that.
Top of that.
This is one guy, skinny little guys, and they're walking it down. They had just packed teams going up and down, but that whole place is stripped and clean. They said we left it cleaner than we came. Fish and Wildlife said that.
And that's important, because we want to go back someday. Well, you know, probably not us, because we promised the Fish and Wildlife folks that if we made enough contacts, it would be 10 years before we pestered them about going back. And we did it. 140,000 contacts with 36,000 individual hams worldwide. And so we'll be leaving the next DXpedition to Navassa to the next generation of hams. But don't count us out yet. We've still got a few good DXpeditions left in us over the next decade. Our thanks to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service for their permission and enthusiastic support of the K1N operation and the KP15 project. We believe that we've demonstrated that their mission to protect the wildlife refuges under their care and our mission to operate ham radio from those rare locations are fully compatible. We make a great team. Our thanks also to our pilots, our off-island team, and our QSL managers. Our corporate sponsors. The many clubs and organizations that provided support. Okay, even more clubs and organizations that provided support. And the thousands of individual hams who made the K1N DXpedition not just possible, but an amazing success. We'll see you on the air.